the wound to six other forensic investigators. They all concurred that it was a stab wound. He also found that Kevin Ives had been smashed in the head with a rifle butt. The report of the grand jury concluded that the deaths of Don Henry and Kevin Ives were definitely the result of foul play. It urged that law enforcement agencies, the prosecuting attorney's office, to continue the investigation into the deaths of Don Henry and Kevin Ives and into the drug problem in Saline County. Because of Linda Ives' investigation into the death of her son, she was placed on Bill Clinton's enemy list by White House counsel Mark Fabian. Already, people associated with the case were beginning to die in what amounted to a reign of terror among young people in Alexander, Arkansas. April 1988, Keith Coney told his mother he knew too much about the Ives-Henry murders and feared for his life. After being slashed in the neck, he was fleeing for his life on his motorcycle when he slammed into the back of a truck and was killed. Booney Bearden, a friend of the boys, disappeared. His body was never found. November 1988, Keith McCaskill claimed to have knowledge of the Ives-Henry murders, but was killed before he could testify. McCaskill, knowing that his life was in danger, had said goodbye to his friends and family. He died from 113 stab wounds. January 1989, Gregory Collins claimed to have knowledge of the Ives-Henry murders, but was killed before he could testify. Collins was found dead from a shotgun blast to the face. April 1989, Jeff Rhodes claimed to have knowledge of the Ives-Henry murders, but was killed before he could testify. His body was found in the city dump, dead of a gunshot wound to the head. July 1989, Richard Winters claimed to have knowledge of the Ives-Henry murders, but was killed before he could testify. Winters was silenced by a blast from a sawed-off shotgun. June 1990, Jordan Kettleson claimed to have information on the Ives-Henry murders, but was killed before he could testify. He died from a shotgun blast to the head. To date, no arrests have been made in regard to these murders. Arkansas's medical examiner ruled the death of two teenage boys an accident, while several forensic investigators and a grand jury concluded they were murdered. But this was not the first nor the last time that Fami Malek's rulings would cause controversy. In 1985, a North Arkansas man was fatally shot, and Fami Malek ruled it a suicide. There were four gunshot wounds to the chest. In a 1986 case, Malek's ruling was accidental drowning. It was later discovered that the victim had been shot in the head. In 1992, a man's body was found with five bullet wounds, but Malek nevertheless ruled it a suicide. In his most incredible ruling, Malek concluded that a James Milam had died of an ulcer. However, the man's skull was later recovered. He had been decapitated with a sharp knife. That Malek survived in Arkansas is a testament to Clinton's power. Just before Clinton announced his intentions to run for president, Malek was moved to another state job. Union boss Arthur Coya has managed to build a political alliance with the Clinton administration. He attended the White House regularly to share breakfast with the First Lady and flew with Clinton on Air Force One. Even as Coya and the President gave each other gifts, such as expensive golf clubs, the Justice Department was filing a civil suit against Coya. It charged that he and his co-conspirators employed actual and threatened force, violence, and fear of physical and economic injury to create a climate of intimidation and fear. Members were intimidated into silence by violence, economic coercion, and by the known ties of local and international union officials with organized crime. Within days after a draft of the suit was delivered to Coya, President Clinton sent him two personal letters. One thanked Coya for his support of Democratic candidates, and another promised to share Coya's views on labor with Labor Secretary Robert Reich.
Mr. Free, over 65 people have invoked the Fifth Amendment or fled the country in the course of the committee's investigation. Have you ever experienced so many unavailable witnesses in any matter in which you've prosecuted or in which you've been involved?
Actually, I have.
You have? Give me a rundown on that real quickly.
I spent about 16 years doing organized crime cases in New York City, and many people were frequently unavailable.
So was that the only time you experienced something like that?
Went on for quite a while.
So the only time that you experienced anything like this was when you were investigating an organized crime syndicate.
On Monday, July 19th, 1993, President Clinton called FBI Director William Sessions to tell him that he was dismissed. It would be the first time in our nation's history that a president had fired an FBI director. He called a second time a few minutes later. The president seemed to be in a hurry. Time was of the essence. Sessions was to leave the Hoover Building effective immediately. The next day, Vince Foster's body was found in Fort Marcy Park, dead from a gunshot wound to the head. Under the assassination statute, the FBI would have been compelled by law to take over the case if there was any question that it might have been a homicide. But with the firing of its director, the FBI was in turmoil, and the Park Police became the lead agency in charge. The Park Service had neither the depth nor the experience to investigate a case of this magnitude, which led many to ponder the question, was it the intention of the White House to limit the scope of the investigation? Vince Foster had been a close friend of Bill Clinton's in their boyhood town of Hope, Arkansas. As Deputy White House Counsel for the Clinton administration, Foster became the highest-ranking U.S. government official to die under mysterious circumstances since President John F. Kennedy. He, more than anyone else, knew the financial secrets of both the campaign of 1992 and the Clinton presidency, just as he knew the secrets of the Rose Law Firm and of Hillary Rodham Clinton's business and financial dealings over the previous decade, dealings that would become the subject of numerous investigations. On July 22nd, Foster's briefcase was searched twice by Bernard Nussbaum, in the presence of Justice Department officials and the U.S. Park Police. 4 days later, a suicide note mysteriously appeared in the briefcase. It was torn into 28 pieces with one piece missing. No fingerprints were found on the note, only a partial palm print of Nussbaum's. Distinguished handwriting experts were contacted, the most famous being Dr. Reginald Alton of Oxford University in England. The note, he said, was a fake. It was the work of a forger. Associate Independent Counsel Mikel Rodriguez was not a conservative. Indeed, when he arrived from California with his ponytail, his earring, and his leather jacket, there were some that said Kenneth Starr had gone too far in his efforts to recruit liberal Democrats and ethnic minorities to his team. Rodriguez spent his time combing through the archive of documents in the Foster case, and he didn't like what he saw. He managed to gain access to the locked files in the office of the independent counsel. Hidden inside was a folder of crime scene photographs that had been deliberately withheld from the prosecutor. Among them was the original Polaroid of Foster's neck. Rodriguez went to the Smithsonian Institution for enhancement of the original. The blow-up photo revealed a dime-sized wound on the right side of Foster's neck, suggesting a gunshot fired at point-blank range into the flesh. The medical examiner at the scene was Dr. Haupt. After examining Foster's body, he made reference to a wound on Foster's neck on page 2 of his report. In agreement with two of the rescue workers who testified before the Whitewater grand jury,